Southampton Water in a clear August dawn. Two Polish sailing vessels riding at anchor. For all the world, ghosts of another maritime age. But for this ship, today will herald the climax of her maiden voyage. She was completed at the Gdansk shipyard less than 3 months ago. And shortly, she will be the youngest and largest attraction of a very distinguished fleet as she arrives in Southampton at the end of her first series of Cutty, Sark tall ships races. But as the Damojezi weighs anchor, the Trinity House pilot weighs up the difficulties of taking a fully rigged sailing ship along Southampton Water and into the busy commercial port of Southampton.
Right, will you increase to full speed, please, and we'll make sure that we get there on time. We have a hard flood tide against us, plus the wind, and we can adjust our speed in Southampton Water.
Damojezi, whose name means gift of youth, is just one of more than 50 vessels which will arrive in Southampton at the end of this tall ships event. Not all of them will be fully rigged ships, some are just yachts, but all are involved in sail training and are crewed by young people. Crew members and experienced officers taking part in the tall ships races, the challenge of bringing these magnificent vessels safely from Falmouth to Lisbon, then to Vigo, and finally here to Southampton has been the opportunity of a lifetime. But for Southampton, this event has brought another invasion. The attraction of the fleet and its crews has drawn huge numbers of people to Southampton to see these majestic sailing vessels from 10 nations. And this poses some unique problems. Immense crowds and traffic chaos are just the start. For 18 months, the city of Southampton and its port have been preparing for the tall ships. Inside the customs hall of the famous ocean terminal, recreation areas were created for the crews. And while the port made ready to welcome the fleet and the thousands of sightseers, Southampton had an early visitor. Set off with her crew of 240, came from the Soviet Union on a courtesy visit to be with the other tall ships. The largest of the tall ships, she's very rarely seen outside her home waters. But even as the fleet arrived, she departed, not without partly stealing the show. Set off was built in 1921 by Krupp in Kiel. She was a German ship until 1945, when she was taken over by the Soviet Union. She was laid up and then refitted and recommissioned in 1981, which hopefully means we'll be seeing a lot more of her. Impressive departure, she passed some of the tall ship's fleet coming up Southampton Water. Eendracht, a Dutch sail training vessel. Behind her, the Malcolm Miller, the pride of the British Sail Training Association. And her sister ship, the other pride of the STA, the Sir Winston Churchill, with a noisy-looking crew. The first vessel to cross the finishing line was United Friendly, an all-male crew with two women as joint skippers. United Friendly, once GB2, is veteran of all three round-the-world races.
Very well indeed, thank you. You did a good race.
As the Friendly Armada came in from the sea, the invasion of sightseers began. With all the extra visitors to the city, Southampton provided 75 extra buses from five other bus companies, apart from those from Southampton's own transport department. They also provided buses and coaches for more than 100 special trips laid on for the crews themselves to visit the rest of the south of England. For some trips, there was a fleet of as many as 20 buses. Two so-called park and ride schemes were provided to try to keep the worst of the traffic congestion from the area of the docks. And the crowds came, enthralled.
I've done that.
Of course, that sort of thing doesn't appeal to everyone. But most were left with happy memories of 50 ships with their musical crews. The ocean dock alongside the old ocean terminal. This was where the great transatlantic liners used to berth. Especially, of course, the two queens, the Queen Elizabeth and the Queen Mary. But this week, it's home for Dame au Jersey, Amarina, Denmark,
Na lirówki tuż przy sterze bieli czerwień na banderze, a z niej orzeł się do lotu.
Pogoria?
Pogoria, brawa, ahoj, nasz egarski dom.
The British naval vessel HMS Cavalier, now a floating museum. Across on this side, the two Swedish naval vessels, Gladden and Falcon, and beyond them, the Malcolm Miller and Sir Winston Churchill, with Eendracht in the corner. In the vast Empress dock, the class 2 and 3 vessels are crowded together in a very friendly way. And they too attract the crowds. By far the greatest attraction was the Dalmorgesi, with her human snake. 309 feet long, she is crewed by 38 officers and about 140 cadets. Everywhere, people were patiently queuing for a glimpse of life on board. Despite the visitors, life on board Danmark carried on as usual. With 100 officers and crew on board, that's 300 meals a day, even here in port. Like most of the ships, the Danmark's crew bake all their own bread and pastries. Think of all that washing up. And of course, all the ships had to be revictualled for the journey home. With 57 vessels and over 1,500 crew, the quantities involved were huge. And of course, there were daily chores. Clothes made wet by Atlantic storms won't dry below decks.
Can I have a stick of us?
Yeah.
So, that's even extra one.
Doen
we niet beter knijpen,
nee?
Dat zou inderdaad wel een
flikker
zijn.
Dat hebben ze hier meegedaan. Geen was.
Nee, de
knijpen
zit achter, dus
dat is
geen zin.
Nou ja, geen was dus.
Stom wel. Many vessels exchanged individual crew members, giving the young people a wonderful opportunity to get to know one another. But coming ashore gave all the crews a chance to share their experiences of the race, despite occasional language difficulties.
Did you have wind all the time?
Oh no, we
had. It came finished there, it was nothing. I think we went backwards.
Yeah.
That's right.
That's
right.
But then coming in here, you really got a lot of wind.
Yeah,
the
two last days we went about 10 or 12 knots.
Yes, right.
It really was something.
Hard on the hill.
Yeah,
it was.
It's pretty hard trying to wobbling.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Bellowing down.
The first, you start from Lisbon, did you?
Yeah.
Start from Lisbon. The first days to Vigo, they were pretty
windy
there, weren't they?
Yeah, pretty tough.
That's pretty tough.
That was the worst part of this trip.
Yeah.
You didn't get seasick, did you?
Yes.
Yeah,
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 on
the
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. From Lisbon to Vigo, got yeah. But not on this no. trip yeah, from right. Vigo.
Yeah, yeah. It's true anyway.
I think everybody was.
Once you got your sea legs.
I see, yeah.
Sea
yeah.
legs. Like about 5 hours or so.
I went issue. Really great.
Yeah.
There are always more important jobs to do on a boat. But while some were cleaning and polishing, others painted the town. And Southampton was ready to welcome them. Everyone had some sort of display to mark the event. Double-decker buses intriguing.
For the leaders, there's a guy on a bike with a bright yellow Marshall's bib on, okay? Now listen, lads and girls.
Part of the city of Southampton's welcome was a wide variety of special events, from races to rock concerts. A 3-mile mini-marathon around the streets of Southampton attracted 132 entries, including a Humpty Dumpty from a local boat, Carillion of White.
When you finish, we all congregate over in there, in that compound.
You know where you are now.
It looks like the Gladden will collect the glory.
Watch this,
Watch this. Armodin wins for the Royal Swedish Navy in an impressive time of 15 minutes 39 seconds. But there were other, less energetic things to do. There was folk music and fireworks, swimming and sailing, concerts and coach trips. I admire their energy. After the Bay of Biscay, I think I'd be happy with simpler things.
Pojechała babarabu, pytajcie z kakadu.
There's nothing more welcome to a sailor returning to shore than the thought of dry clothes, a hot shower, and a good yarn with the other crews. And that's one of the principal aims of this event, to bring the crews together here in Southampton. So the rules take into account the ship's sailing handicap up until the time of the finishing deadline. Then every vessel, even those which haven't actually crossed the finishing line, can make all speed into port, using engines if necessary. For Duet, this means that she has won the entire race overall, despite still being 10.3 miles behind the finishing line at the close of racing. Which is nice, because she was launched at Samuel White's shipyard here in Southampton exactly 70 years ago. So homecoming has brought special celebrations.
Well, team, after all the hard work, we've managed to get first in our class and first overall. Yay!
For the crew of Duet, it was a chance to get their own back on the ship's buoy. For young Eddie Thompson from Hill Head near Southampton, it was rather a wet celebration. And, of course, the ultimate climax of his race.
Well, I think the penultimate of this trip has been actually finding out about half an hour ago that we've won and then getting chucked in the water. But I think it's been a great experience for me. I've certainly enjoyed it. I think everybody else on board has enjoyed it as well. We had a very varied race. We started off with frustrating light winds and, you know, it wasn't very good for morale, and then when we got into Bay of Biscay we had fairly strong following winds, which was far more exciting, and we got to Ushant with having to average about 8 knots to make the line, and in fact we averaged 7.5, and we covered 160 miles I think in 24 hours across the channel in the gale, which was very exciting, and I think that just made the trip for me. And the people are great. We all do the cooking, etc., and it's great fun. It's fantastic. Really enjoy it.
For the captains, there were more refined events. A cocktail party aboard the Malcolm Miller and Sir Winston Churchill.
Especially in the Winchester, some nice places we visited during our stay in Southampton, that really it will be for us something very remarkable.
You are, Mary is my wife, but I'm not, but I love Southampton, it's my adopted son. By road, rail, sea, air, we've got the best communications, and the port facilities are absolutely marvellous.
Yes.
And there's no better place that you can host an event on quite so. The only thing I've
In the morning, it's back to work. A briefing for the captains on the arrangements for the parade of sail by Captain Chris Phelan and Captain Malcolm Ridge, the dock and harbour master.
An important feature here, we have two Sea Cadet MFVs which will be moored on the radar reference line, which will give you your indicator for turning this bend here. It's a very sharp bend, but to enable the Isle of Wight to get the spectacle, we would like you to maintain this course. And then heading up towards one of the large boats here, Lionheart, and then making for Gilkicker. So your spectators are in Stokes Bay will get the advantage. And then after passing Gilkicker, straight on a course to between Warner Boy and Horse Elbow Boy.
You'll notice here the marker vessels are always on your port hand side. They're all to port.
Once we are in formation and proceeding into Southampton, down Southampton Water, we may ask you to increase speed to 6 knots. Is that possible? Each group will be led by a Class A vessel, with the exception of one group, which is being led by United Friendly. We thought we would do this as she was first over the line. We'll give you the honour, madam.
How we will say to her?
Your Royal Highness on the first time.
Yes.
And then man after that.
Yes. Your Royal Highness.
Yes.
Thank you for your lesson.
The captain of the Damozhezi comes from the other side of the Iron Curtain. Today, he'll meet a princess.
I think so.
Have you met her before?
No.
She's but very,
she's
a charming person.
Charming
lovely.
Person, yes. She's a charming person and very popular. Very popular in Britain.
And so will they. I wonder what they think of it. Prince Philip started this series of races a month ago, and this royal visit by Princess Alexandra marks the finish. The princess was accompanied by her husband, the Honourable Angus Ogilvy.
Bonza! Bonza!
The girls of the Malcolm Miller give the princess a special welcome. The crew of the Danmark were inspected by the princess. And presented her with a special gift of Danish pottery. While appropriately enough, Royalist gave her three royal cheers. The crews marched to the prize giving at the Guild Hall to the sound of the Royal Marines Band.
Thank you.
A Division 1, a prize donated by the Cutty Sark agent in Spain, Dar Mojeji. First, on corrected time in Class A Division 2, a glass plate donated by the Falmouth Sail 82 Committee, Pogoria. First, on corrected time in Class C Division 1, a ceramic statuette donated by the Vigo Committee, Duet. By the vote of the captains in the fleet, the Cutty Sark Trophy is awarded this year to Urania.
Urania won not only because her crew entered fully into the spirit of the race, but because she went to the assistance of other vessels on two occasions, once to put her doctor onto a yacht with an injured crew member, and again to tow a stranded yacht off a shingle bank. Thank you. Royalist leaves the ocean dock with the dock cranes dipping their jibs in salute. It's time for the grand finale. Today is the parade of sail.
Well, it's nearly 6 months to the day now since the anchor was straight up and down, and we started our voyage away, lads, from our families in Southampton town. Well, I don't say that it's been a good trip this time. The old man has come out his time. All the watch keepers say, while the day workers smile, think that next time I'll sign on the day an old line got down.
There'll be 57 sailing vessels in 8 groups, each led by a Class A vessel, like a mother duck leading her young, down Southampton Water and into the Solent. Then away, behind the Isle of Wight, to their home ports, wherever they may be, to the Baltic, Gdansk, Copenhagen and Stockholm, to Hamburg and Lisbon, Dublin, and Amsterdam.
Then we'll slow to take on our sea pilot for the run from the
leading the parade of sail, the Trinity House vessel Stella. And as the winner of the Falmouth to Lisbon leg, Royalist heads the first group.
Well, the rummagers rummage wherever they choose.
The Malcolm Miller, a 153-foot topsail schooner with, on this occasion, an all-girl crew. She was built in 1968, largely thanks to Sir James Miller, once a Lord Mayor of London, after whose son the Malcolm Miller is named.
There'll be tears, there'll be kisses, the kids and the misses. I'm getting the channels again.
And her sister ship, the Sir Winston Churchill, 2 years older and Britain's first sail training ship. The funds for building her were raised entirely by public subscription.
Well, McGear is all back from the cleaners, and I've built up me customs for two, and quite soon now we'll start on the forums. Until there is no work to do, well, we'll slow down for fully, it won't be long then till we're passing the old school now. We'll be signing all particles.
Royalist sets the pace at a regulation 4 knots to ensure that all the fleet can keep up. For Denmark, leading the second group, it's difficult to decide just how much sail to raise.
24 hours and then there'll be tears, there'll be kisses, the kids and the misses. I'm getting the channels again. Oh yes, we're on the downhill line, Southampton, here we come. 24 hours and then there'll be tears.
Abeam of Royalist, the fire tender gives the fleet a traditional Southampton farewell.
I'm getting the channel.
From Western Shore, the holiday crowds could see the splendour of the head of the parade. Thousands of small craft swarm around the fleet, a veritable armada of sail. Behind Gladden, Duet again. She's a 50-foot gaff yawl, built in 1912 and on permanent loan to the Ocean Youth Club of Gosport. And having a little trouble with her gaff, by the look of it. The mighty Danmark again, with her upper and lower topsails drawing nicely. Well out of the ocean dock now, here's Pogoria with her distinctive sails bearing the insignia of four interlinked shackles. She'll be heading the fourth group. And behind her, Eendracht. Built in Holland in 1974, she's a steel, gaff-rigged schooner, 107 foot long. Her design is similar to our own Sir Winston Churchill and Malcolm Miller, though she's somewhat smaller. Her crew of 38 includes 29 young people under 25, and she's run by the Dutch equivalent of the Sail Training Association. The tugs are just pulling out d'Armojezie. She'll be heading the sixth group. And this is Royalist, now well underway. A brig, Royalist was launched by Princess Anne at Cowes in 1971. She's painted like a Black Wall frigate with mock gun ports. Owned by the Sea Cadet Association, she has a permanent crew of five and is carrying 22 cadets, including six women. In all, she's provided training for some 7,000 cadets travelling over 80,000 miles in the Channel, the Baltic, and the North Sea. She was the winner of the Falmouth to Lisbon leg. Behind the Churchill and the Miller, the Gladden. Like her sister ship, the Falcon, she's used for training cadets for the Royal Swedish Navy. Her crew of 41 includes 35 young people. She cruises in the Baltic, the North Sea, and across the Atlantic, and is a previous winner of the Cutty Sark Trophy. And of course, the Danmark. She's a full-rigged steel ship, 212 foot long. She carries 1,600 square meters of sail and a staggering 8,000 meters of running ropes. Her main mast rises 130 feet above the deck, and her main yard is 66 feet wide. She's owned by the Danish government and is crewed by 20 officers and 80 cadets. Built in 1933, she's one of the oldest sail training ships in active use. When the Second World War broke out, she was in America and was lent to the US Coast Guard as a training ship. 5,000 American cadets trained in her before she was returned to Denmark in 1945. Denmark's cadets still sleep in hammocks and have traditional sea chests. Pagoria. Like the Damojezi, she's a Polish vessel, but 2 years older. She's a barkentine, which means she's square-rigged on only one of her three masts. She was built at Gdansk and carries a crew of 45, including 21 young people, many of whom have won their places in competitions run by Polish television. The emblem on her sails is that of the Iron Shackle Fraternity, a youth opportunities scheme. The tiny Jolly Breeze, perhaps the most famous racing yacht of all time, having won the Fastnet race 3 times. Originally a pilot cutter, she's almost 70 years old now and spends her winters at the Exeter Maritime Museum and her summers being sailed by the pupils of Dauncey's school. Southampton is used to great liners passing up and down Southampton Water. It's been a port since Roman times, but I doubt if it's ever seen a sight quite like this. Amorina from Sweden leads the 6th and last group in the parade of sail. 118 foot long, she's a barkentine, and her crew of 28 includes 8 women. Amorina's a fairly elderly lady now. She was built in 1933, and she served as an icebreaker and as a lightship, though not at the same time. This is the Royal Victoria Country Park at Netley. It was in this setting that an enormous hospital was built for soldiers from the Crimean War. The chapel, with its tower, is all that's left. The Armada has reached the Solent now. Turning round Calshot's Bit with its crowds of spectators, and the famous Calshot Light Vessel. The tall ships brought a new spectacle to Southampton. They also brought their message of international understanding and friendship. Because while young people sail together and face the dangers of storm and tide together, the differences of nations and cultures seem somewhat irrelevant. In that same spirit, Each host port is proud of its chance to welcome the Cutty Sark tall ships and their crews. Southampton certainly was.
Ladies and gentlemen, you have received a welcome you will never forget from the great maritime city of Southampton. And now all I would like to say to each and every one of you is well done. Acute discomfort there will have been during the past 4 weeks, but win or lose, you must all feel proud to have crewed in these remarkable races. And the memories which will remain most vivid will be the friendships you have made and the magic of the sea, the sky, and the sails. And I suspect, too, that most of you will be hoping to go through the agony and the ecstasy all over again.